In the first century, the area around Philadelphia is extremely fertile, and the region is known for its fabulous grapes and wine. It's also famous for its hot springs, which draw people from all over the world to bathe in its medicinal waters. And the city is known, as it still is today, for its bread. Appearing in a vision to the Apostle John, Jesus says, "Write this to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. This is the message from the one who is holy and true, the one who has the key of David. What he opens, no one can close, and what he closes, no one can open. I know all the things you do, and I have opened a door for you that no one can close. You have little strength, but you obeyed my word and did not deny me. Look, I will force those who belong to Satan's synagogue, those liars who say they're Jews but are not, to bow down at your feet. They will acknowledge that you are the ones I love. Because you have obeyed my command to persevere, I will protect you from the great time of testing that will come upon the whole world to test those who belong to this world. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have, so no one will take away your crown. All who are victorious will become pillars in the temple of my God, and they will never have to leave it. And I will write on them the name of my God, and they will be citizens in the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches." But before he describes the church, he describes himself, and he says, "I am holy." That word means separate or set apart, and when it's applied to God, it refers to his divinity and the fact that by his very nature, he is above and far beyond anything else in creation. So Jesus is saying he is divine. He is God. And then he says he is true. The sense here is that he not only speaks the truth, he's faithful and reliable. So when he makes promises to the church, he can be trusted. Not only that, but Jesus holds the key of David. In other words, he has authority over the house of Israel and the entire world. The passage here is an echo of Isaiah 22:22. There, the prophet refers to Eliakim, who becomes the palace administrator for King Hezekiah. "I will give him the key to the house of David, the highest position in the royal court," God says. "When he opens doors, no one will be able to close them. When he closes doors, no one will be able to open them." Just as the palace official had control over the royal palace and the treasures of the king, Jesus has control over heaven and its treasures. He actually alludes to that at the very start of Revelation when he tells John, "I hold the keys to death and the grave." Divinity, reliability, authority. Jesus has them all. So the believers can trust him when he says he'll open a door for them that will never be shut. That door imagery is important for two reasons. First, the city was founded by King Attalus of Pergamum, who loved his brother Humanus so much, he named the place Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. But eventually the Greeks took over, so their language and their culture became dominant, and Philadelphia was key to making that happen. That's because of its location between two continents. The major road leading from Europe to Asia went right through Philadelphia, so it was known as the door to the east. First, the city helped spread Greek culture to Asia, and then it became a major door for Christianity. In the New Testament, The writers often describe spreading the faith as God opening a door for the gospel. To the church in the Greek city of Corinth, the Apostle Paul says, "A great door for effective work has opened to me, even though many oppose me." And in Colossians 4, he says, "Pray also for us, that God may open a door for the word, so we may proclaim Christ." So maybe Jesus is telling the Christians he'll open a door for them for the continuing spread of the gospel, despite everything they're going through and how powerless they feel. And we too must remember that God is sovereign and in control, and that if we will hold fast, he'll use us as a door to help people find their way from the world into the kingdom of God. But it won't depend on how big or talented we are. It will depend on God's power and how faithful we remain. When Jesus talks about the synagogue of Satan, also mentioned in the letter to the church in Smyrna, it probably refers to tension between traditional Jews and those becoming followers of Christ. Because, as in other places, the first Christians in Turkey are converts from Judaism, and there's evidence they're getting thrown out of the synagogue. And that could lead to complete estrangement and alienation from friends, family, and those who would otherwise support your business. Because the synagogue was not just the center of religious life, it was the focal point for everything social and economic. So getting banned affected everything. It could even cost you your life. And that's because the Jews were exempt from having to worship the emperor because they made a deal with Rome. They were an official religion. But once your name was struck from the synagogue, you were no longer considered a Jew. That meant you had to acknowledge Caesar as God. And failure to do so could lead to beatings, banishment, and sometimes death. Of course, the Jews in the synagogue consider themselves the chosen people, favored by God merely because of their ancestry. And they do have the upper hand over the Christians. But Jesus says that control won't last. He writes, "Look, I will force those who belong to Satan's synagogue, those liars who say they're Jews but are not, to bow at your feet. They will acknowledge that you are the ones I love." But for the time being, the Philadelphia Christians are on their own, so the church is very small, and Jesus says it doesn't have much strength. In other words, it's just like us. But Jesus sends a message of hope and encouragement. To those under persecution from the Jews, he says, "Hold on. Keep going, and don't give up." It's a message we still need today. We need to remember that Jesus is not impressed by attendance numbers or influence or how much money we give. He values faithfulness, especially faithfulness amid hardship, and that must be what we're all about. In the Revelation, Jesus tells three churches to endure, despite pressure and persecution. It's just part of the package when you're a follower of Christ. Remember back to Revelation 2:10. "If you remain faithful even to the point of death, I will give you the crown of life." And he reiterates that to those in Philadelphia and commends them for their obedience, their refusal to deny him, and their perseverance. Then he makes them a promise. "I will protect you from the great time of testing that will come upon the whole world to test those who belong to this world. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so no one will take away your crown." So, like in Smyrna, more trouble is on the way. But Jesus tells the Philadelphians he's got their backs. He reminds them they don't belong to this world, and that ultimate victory will be theirs if they hold on to their faith. Now here's something ironic. Of all the seven churches mentioned in Revelation, there are the fewest remains in Philadelphia. As in Smyrna, the modern city is built over top the ancient one, and few old features are preserved. But the most visible are these pillars from a 6th century basilica dedicated to the Apostle John. So even 500 years after the Revelation, the memory and legacy of John were preserved in Philadelphia. and the pillars still bear witness to Jesus and his church. And in John's vision, Jesus says, "All who are victorious will become pillars in the temple of my God, and they will never have to leave it." That temple is incredibly more important than the synagogue, and they will be fixtures in that temple. And unlike the remnants here, that holy temple will never fall or decay. So the pillar is a symbol of strength and stability. And in the same way, we are anchored in Jesus, who keeps us safe even when trouble and turmoil threaten to shake our lives to the very foundation. In him, we can stand firm. And as Jesus ends his letter of encouragement, he says of the faithful, "I will write on them the name of my God, for they will be citizens in the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven. And I will also write on them my new name." So, a new city and a new name. That would have had special significance to the Christians in this area because in 17 AD, a catastrophic earthquake leveled 10 cities, including Sardis and Philadelphia. But the Emperor Tiberius was generous to Philadelphia and gave lots of money toward its rebuilding. In gratitude, the residents temporarily renamed the city Neo Caesarea, or New City of Caesar. So the believers know what it means to get a new city and a new name. Only the ones from God will last forever. So here are some life lessons from the faithful in Philadelphia. First, Jesus holds the keys to life and death and life again. So when trouble strikes, keep your eyes and heart on the big picture and the important stuff. Second, he uses his divinity, reliability, and authority to bless us when we remain faithful. We can trust him. Third, we and our church must be the door between the world and the kingdom of God. So let's pray for him to open up the opportunities for us. We need to proclaim Christ in everything we do and all we are. Fourth, God is not impressed with church size, influence, or budgets. He values love and faithfulness above all else. So let's make that our focus. Five, amid adversity, endure, persevere, hold on, and hang tight, because in the end, we win. Anything we go through now will be worth it. And last, God promises us a new life and a new home in an unshakable kingdom that will last forever. So be a pillar of the kingdom, not just the community. And while we're waiting, let's each do our best to make the church a community of brotherly and sisterly love.